We are moving away from the country focus that we've had in the last couple of sessions to be very much focusing on this question of drugs, art, and society. And we have a very interesting and a very mixed panel. Alvaro, Enrigue, and Reyna Grande, and Eduardo Rabasa, who joined us for the panel on Mexico yesterday. And I'm also delighted to introduce and welcome to the CU, Bryan Lewis Saunders. Now, we're going to be very free-flowing in this session, but one thing that I thought it was very important to do, first of all, was just to ground us all, really, in understanding this notion of the war on drugs. And there was a comment in from the audience the other day that the notion of the war on drugs was very ahistorical, that there was a lack of a historical narrative. So I always find it helpful when I'm teaching to remind my students that 120 years ago, cannabis, opium, cocaine, marijuana were routinely available and routinely prescribed. And this is actually an image from a Victorian poster for Mrs. Winslow's soothing syrup, which was an opium remedy for babies that didn't sleep. And if you gave them 100% pure opium, they usually slept forever. But the whole point here is that this was a very good way of medication. Heroin was routinely available. And this was obviously a period before we had professional health services, so people had to routinely medicate themselves. Even the Pope was in on the act with his coca tonic, which contained pure cocaine and also wine. And as you may be aware, this was ultimately banned because it contained wine. So we move towards a period at the turn of the century where we're moving towards a model of prohibition. And this model of prohibition was very much led by the United States of America, and it was fueled by concerns in particular over immigration from Italy, from China, and from Mexico. And this was a news article from the New York Times in 1917, which was talking about the new risk of Negro cocaine fiends. And the argument that was made by the US federal government was that when African Americans used cocaine, it made them bulletproof. And therefore, this drug had to be subject to international control. There was also profound concerns over morphine addiction and morphine dependency, because morphine, which is a derivative of opium, was routinely prescribed largely to women. And it was prescribed for a whole range of illnesses, PMT, hypersexuality, wanting to wear trousers, wanting to vote, a whole range of disorders. So we had a whole gamut of problems of addiction and dependency and overdose, which lead us into this ideology of prohibition. And this is a picture from the alcohol prohibition. And as you can see here, lips that touch liquor shall not touch ours. Although really, I don't really think that's much of an incentive not to drink liquor. But this was a very powerful ideology at the turn of the century. And my argument would be very much that drug prohibition is an evangelical Christian movement. This is what prohibition looked like at the turn of the 20th century, and this is what prohibition looks like today. The ideology hasn't changed, but the means of enforcing it has become violent and brutal and has cost millions of lives. And what I found very moving about William Sterling's discussion earlier today was the notion of how you address the concerns of the poor, the most marginalized, the most vulnerable. And drug policy is an area where really most of us have many prejudices. We have prejudices about drug users, we have prejudices about drug traffickers, and we have prejudices about those who are involved in the production and manufacture of drugs. And I would argue very strongly that these prejudices really need to be confronted, because these are overwhelmingly the most vulnerable and marginalized groups in society. Children play a very important role in the drug trade, and children are disproportionately impacted by the violence of the drug trade and by violent counter-narcotics operations. And one of the points we were making in the Mexico session is that so much of our counter-narcotics activities are focused on cocaine from Colombia and from Mexico and from Peru, and also on opium. But if you look at this table here, which due to my very rapid graphics is slightly missing an edge, you'll see that the most widely consumed drugs in the world are actually ATSs and ecstasy. And these drugs are overwhelmingly produced in the global north. So if you just look at the level of drug use globally, you'll see here that cocaine is the least consumed drug in the world, 0.3% of the population. So the very controversial point is if you're going to bomb and annihilate any civilization, it really should be the Dutch and the Americans, because these are the world's leading drug producers. But for some reason, we remain fixated on cocaine and opiates. And what we've tended to see in Latin America in particular is because of the violence around the drug trade that the drug traffickers have themselves become seen as quite legitimate state actors. This was a point that was made on our panel the other day. This is a picture of Pablo Escobar, who you may be, you may not be directly familiar with Pablo Escobar, but you may have heard of him. And you can see here this kind of immortalization of the shooting of Pablo Escobar, people transformed into legends and icons. And this really is the key issue, and this will bring me to Bryan in a minute, who will talk about his own experience of incarceration in the US, which is this graph over here, the map of those countries that incarcerate over 5,000 people per million. And you'll see the only country that does that is the United States. And the controversial point that I've made before is that levels of incarceration in the US are just slightly below levels of incarceration in the Soviet Union during the Soviet period. And you'll see in this graph here this huge spike that occurs in US incarceration in the 1980s. And this is the introduction of very, very punitive mandatory drug laws in the United States of America. We now have a figure of around 1 in 4 African Americans are imprisoned. And you see this disproportionate impact in this bar chart at the bottom here of drug laws on the black community and also on the Latino community. And the key thing here is how you police drug laws, because clearly if you're going to be policing marginalized communities, they're very vulnerable to very intensive and heavy policing, and this is why we see this incredible disproportionality. Astonishingly, America seems to be waking up now that we have this raging opioid epidemic, because this is impacting the white community, and this is really, finally, seems to be transforming US attitudes. But the key thing is that this massive rate of incarceration, which has occurred since the 1990s, is having a devastating effect on one particular group, and this is women in Latin America. And you'll see here this sharp escalation in the number of women who are in prison for drug-related offenses. If you look at Nicaragua on the end there, 90% of women in prison are in jail for drug-related offenses. And usually, what we know from the work of people like the Washington Office on Latin America is that these are single women. They are usually coerced into some form of drug trafficking activity. They're usually arrested carrying or selling a very small amount in terms of money of drugs, usually less than $100, and yet they can be looking at a period in prison of over 7 years. In some countries, the imprisonment for crimes related to drug trafficking are higher than crimes related to rape or murder. Such is the severity of this drug war. And this is the images that we have of these incarceration figures, and please think about what happens to the children when their mothers are imprisoned for these long periods of time. And a particular problem is that obviously Latin America is not the best place in the world to be ramming people into prisons. And we have had terrible, terrible rights abuses and massacres in Latin America. But the key thing that I just wanted to finish off on here is that talking about drug wars and the human rights abuses which are linked to the drug wars is not about the terrible violence associated with counter-narcotics. It's also about the over-regulation of drugs which have a dual purpose. Opioids in particular are crucial in terms of palliative care and the fight against terrible, terrible pain. And what we know is that just 7 countries in the world, you can maybe just see it on the end of that graph there, 7 countries in the world consume over 80% of global opioid stocks. So we have a global crisis of pain. We have people dying of cancer. In the majority of countries in the world, these blue countries on the top here, people dying of cancer, late stage terminal illness, who only have access to probably paracetamol. And this is because of the catastrophic overregulation of these drugs. And the aim of this overregulation is to stop apparent seepage of opioids into society where they can be abused. And these are pictures from Switzerland, Zurich's Needle Park in the 1980s, where people were openly injecting. And what we try and emphasize to our students, and what's very heavily supported, thankfully, by Mr. George Soros, is the importance of harm reduction in terms of drug control. And in particular, moving away from our own moral judgments about why people are using drugs, but to reduce the harm that these cause to individuals, to families, and to communities. So this was Needle Park in the 1980s, and this is Needle Park today. And that's due to some incredible policies by the former Swiss president, Ruth Dreyfus. And this is a model that we would like to see extended across the world. But one person who has been developing a very interesting personal narrative through the use of his art is Bryan. And Bryan will talk to you about his experience, both of being a drug user, how he manifests his mind on drugs in different artworks, and also the challenge that we have in terms of harm reduction and imprisonments and these wider themes. So with that very vague introduction, Bryan, which isn't really a question, I would like to hand over to you.
Thank you, and I want to just say thanks for inviting me here, and I don't know my opinion. I believe as long as you have a population of people anywhere, some of those people are going to do drugs. It's just human beings. In any type of country, civilization, anywhere, there's people that do drugs. Now, when I was a child, I liked to get dizzy, and I would like spin in circles until I got dizzy, and then it progressed into other types of things, and it's just, I think, really as simple as that, just wanting to have fun, change your brain, and it's not a crime, it's just a health thing, really. But I also want to talk about when I was young, maybe 21, I got arrested in Washington, D.C. and went to prison. This was in 1990, and I went to prison for a violent crime. And there was a lot of racism, for sure, really, in the whole prison system, the judicial system, everything. And but because I was white, and I didn't get a long prison sentence, even though I was a violent criminal. And I was charged with two armed robberies and assault with intent to commit robbery while armed. I'm sorry, I hardly talk about this very much. Okay, so I went to prison for this, and a lot of the black people told me right away, they said, you won't be here long, you're white, don't worry about it. And I would say, no, you don't know, I did some violent crimes and everything like that. And there were people in this prison all the time, every day coming there, that would have like one crack rock, 4 years in prison. They have the barber, he was an older man, he was about 60, 70 years old. 30 years minimum sentence, he had $10 worth of marijuana. And a lot of times in the news in the United States, people will mention these things like anecdotes. And they'll say, like, these sentences are wrong, this is the way it is. And it's really hard for white people, unless they've seen it firsthand, to really think, like, there's whole prison cell blocks full of people like this. It's not just one person in this prison that was unlucky, had marijuana, and got 30 years. And the way they had, under the Clintons, the way they had set it up was that it was like a, I believe, now this is just me, I believe that they made it legal to discriminate because they had the civil rights movement in the United States with Martin Luther King and different people, and they, black people had the right to vote and everything like that. Well, they said they could not discriminate against people for being black or their skin color anymore. So what they did was, whether it was intentional or not, I think it was intentional, but whether it was intentional or not, I believe they made it legal to discriminate against people if they were criminals. And so all of these people, marijuana was the worst kind of drug there is. It's a class one list of drugs, schedule one, right up there with psychedelics, more than cocaine or anything. And so when you get arrested with the marijuana, they give you a felony. Well, now they can discriminate against you. They don't let you have access to education anymore if you've had marijuana. They don't let you, you can get refused for housing, or rent an apartment, a loan for anything like a car or whatever. you lose your right to vote. And so all of a sudden, through the legal system, they totally get rid of a huge portion of people, not to mention destroy the entire black family by taking all the fathers away from all the people. So but I was white, and even though I did violent crimes, I got out really quickly. And without getting too much into all that, I became an artist. And I believe I went to college, and I studied art. And I really believe that art can change people, and that art can really, really make a difference in the world. And I don't really know how to say it, but I think everything that I've done in my life for the last, say, almost 30 years is because of my skin color, I was afforded this opportunity to be able to be an artist and go to college and stuff like that. And I really don't know how else to say it, but I'm aware of my privilege of being white in America.
Thank you very much, Bryan. That was very powerful. And maybe we can come back to Alta's therapy, which was something that I know you're very passionate about. We strongly argue within our teaching on drug policy in the school and through the Open Society Foundations that there's no such thing as a war on drugs. It's actually a war on people. And on that note, I would like to turn to Reyna Grande, who some of us saw on the Mexico panel the other day. And Reyna, if you could maybe share some insights from your hometown of Iguala and the impact of the drug war on your communities.
Yeah, well, like I mentioned yesterday, those of you who were here in the panel, I talked about my hometown of Iguala, Guerrero. And Guerrero is the second poorest state in Mexico. Now it's one of the most violent states as well, but it's also the largest producer of heroin in Mexico, because Mexico has become the number one supplier of heroin to the US, and the state of Guerrero grows the most poppies. So in my hometown, when I was growing up there, you know, we were just dealing with the poverty. There was a lot of poverty, a lack of jobs, lack of opportunities. And my hometown is surrounded by mountains. And I used to love those mountains when I was little because I used to pretend that my father and my mother were on the other side of the mountains, that that's where the U.S. was, because in Mexico we call the U.S. el otro lado, the other side. And I would always look at these mountains and think of my parents being on the other side and not being so far from me, where in fact they were 2,000 miles away from me. But I mentioned these mountains because I write about them in my books. But these mountains have changed over the years because now, in addition to the poverty in Iguala, we're also dealing with a lot of changes. Like, for example, the mountains are now covered in poppy fields, whereas, you know, 30 years ago, that was not the case. But now you go into the mountains and you see a bunch of poppies everywhere that the cartels are growing there. And the locals are the ones who are harvesting these crops. When the students disappeared in 2014, the locals went into the mountains to look for the students, but also to look for all their lost loved relatives that they have that have gone missing. Because as we know, the 43 are just the tip of the iceberg. You know, there's like, I think, over 22,000 missing. And so when the students disappeared, the local people in Iguala, they came together to start looking for the missing. And they were looking for the students, but they were also looking for their lost relatives. And they found over 120 mass graves around the hills and the mountains of Iguala. And when they, you know, dug out these bodies in the graves and they realized that they were not the students, the Mexican government's response was, well, if it's not the students, let's just keep looking. Instead of saying, well, then who are these people? You know, who are all these bodies? Who did they belong to? Who are the families that these people belong to? And so that has kind of become the situation in Iguala, you know, like the puppies there, the mass graves that are being found. So it has been pretty unstable, but one of the things that I want to point out is that I think there's a love-hate relationship with the cartel and with the production of heroin, because in one hand, you know, it does create violence and instability, but on the other hand, the people there don't really have a lot of options in terms of how do you survive, how do you make a living, because there are no jobs, you know, there are no jobs, and whatever jobs there are very low paying. So, for example, with my family, you know, they're making about $8 a day working full time. And just to bring that into perspective, a pizza costs $12, and people make $8 a day. So they can't even afford a pizza. Even that's a luxury. So, you know, my uncles and my cousins who work at factories, that's what they're making, $8 a day. But if you go into the fields and you harvest poppies, you could make up to three times as much in a day than if you have, you know, a job in a factory. So these are some of the things that I feel that we need to talk about when we talk about, you know, drugs, because we have to look at how the lack of opportunities, the poverty, sometimes create a situation where even if people don't approve of these things, or they wish that you know, this wasn't happening, they don't have a lot of options, and then they go into the fields, and they're the ones who are harvesting the poppies, they're the ones who are growing the poppies, because they don't have many options. And in terms, you know, I was reading some articles about growers of poppies, and they were saying how they really don't want to be growing this crop, but if they start growing other things like, you know, avocados or lemons or, you know, fruit, other kinds of fruit, they have no way to get it to the market because there are no roads into the market. You know, they're all, because like I mentioned yesterday about the street where I grew up, was a dirt road, and 30 years later, it's still a dirt road because the government has not bothered to really improve the quality of life for the people there. So you have all these dirt roads, and so the infrastructure doesn't really help people. Even if they don't want to be doing it, they still have to do it. So in this article that I was reading, you know, there were the growers who were saying, we don't want to be growing poppies, but how can we grow avocados if we can't even get them to market? Whereas with poppies, it's so easy to transport it and to ship it out, and it's so lucrative. You know, you make so much more money. So these are some things that I really would like to have a conversation about, like people feeling forced to do something that they don't want to do because there are really not a whole options out there for them.
Thank you very much, Reyna. And I think the point that Reyna makes here, which is so very powerful, is that it is really this lack of choice. And what we do know from cultivators of drug crops is that people aren't doing this because they want to drive around in expensive cars or on Harley Davidson motorcycles. They're doing this because this is simply a livelihoods option. One of the questions that I wanted to put to Eduardo, and I'll come to Alvaro in a minute, whether he thinks there's some kind of capitalist conspiracy here about poverty, which is an important theme here, clearly. Eduardo, please feel free to make any comment that you would like in terms of this notion of the war on drugs. But one of the things that Reyna mentioned before, and which also Bryan has raised, is these voices of the excluded. It's very hard for us to work with drug crop cultivators and design strategies that help them because they're criminals. It's very difficult for us to engage in drug crop cultivating communities because these are people who are under the conventions are criminals. So it's hard to help them. It's hard to justify helping them. Drug users are criminalized. How in publishing and how in your experience of Mexico do we start to give a voice through the arts to these excluded and marginalized communities?
Well, I think it's a very good question, and I think it has to do with something that we discussed yesterday also on the panel about the dominating narratives or the dominating mythologies associated with this subject. I think that Bryan's argument is a very compelling one in terms of the sort of class or skin profiling that goes on in the U.S. But I think that that argument could be extended to what you were referring in the beginning, Jolie, of the different treatment, the different policies, and obviously the different impact, especially in the death toll of the different countries. I didn't know what you mentioned, but I was really impacted by what you said, that many poorer countries don't have access to opiates, so there's like an epidemic of pain. So it would seem like some countries are getting like the benefits of the drugs, if one could call them like that, of getting high on the recreational part, and other countries are paying like the bad part of it. But I think that this is all built on a narrative, and I think that there is a very, to my mind, and this might be wrong, but this is the way I see it, a very clear example. For example, everybody knows who are the big drug lords in Mexico and in Colombia, and there's this whole mythology of Chapo Guzman and Pablo Escobar, and there are movies, and there are songs, and they're in some ways idolized. But for example, at least to my knowledge, there is not the equivalent in, I don't know who the Chapo Guzman of the Netherlands is. I mean, I don't think that is well known, and I think it has to do with this sort of profiling or mythologizing, which makes it into a narrative where these are like the most wanted guy by the FBI, and they are the public enemies, and we have to go after them. But we don't know who the equivalents are of them in the richer countries, and I think it has to do also with something else that you mentioned, Julia, when you said that it was a sort of evangelical or Christian movement or morals, because that leads to hypocrisy, and I think that that is a case that we are dealing with, and even within the societies, I think that within Mexico, it's also the case of what Bryan was talking about happens, because usually the drug dealers or the people who are selling the drugs or cultivating them are from a very clear racial and socio-economical profile, so it's very easy to label them as you were saying, like the bad guys who should be combated, who should be put to death, who should be put in jail. I really don't know if there is a way in the short run to change it, but if there would, I would say that it has to do with changing this narrative, maybe the people, the artists, I mean, I would say the politicians, but I don't think there's like much of a chance that mainstream politicians are gonna do this. But I think that it's very important that these subjects are put out there, so that the narrative of drugs being bad and not taking drugs is good, and everybody that does drugs or produces drugs is a criminal that should be put to death or to jail. I think that the way to combat it is to say, and for example, your presentation is very clear. I mean, not even the statistical data supports that narrative. So it's a narrative that has been long running and imposed, and that has terrible effects. But I would say that if the arts or if the writers or if the publishers or whomever has anything to do, it would have to be like this, like doing pro-legalization campaigns or even perhaps before legalization, like doing a campaign to say that it's not so true that the effects are such. In the case of Mexico, and I'll just finish with this, but it's very striking because, for example, there is a huge alcohol problem in Mexico, and it creates a lot of domestic violence, especially against women, a lot of car crashes, it tears apart and it ruins many families, but it's very embedded in the macho culture. So if you're a proper Mexican, you drink tequila and you get high and you go and have sex with a prostitute. And it's very difficult to combat this narrative, and alcohol is obviously a perfectly legal drug. I mean, I've never seen anybody high on weed. I mean, of the drugs that I can think of, maybe cocaine is the only one that tends to get people aggressive, but all the other ones don't have this aggressive effect that alcohol does. But for a vast majority of Mexicans, it's perfectly okay to get super drunk, to be violent, to be a macho, to be misogynistic, but drugs are, again, of criminals. And I think that, I mean, I'm not super optimistic, especially in the short run, but I think that if there was a way, it would have to be through the mentality of trying to change these things, which are completely wrong, and I think that do a lot of damage.
Thank you very much. If anybody's confused just on the medical morphine, the opioids issue, the key sources for pharmaceutical opioids, so codeine, morphine, are Tasmania, France, India, and the United Kingdom. And clearly I feel particularly proud to see the United Kingdom in there as being one of these special countries, which is allowed to provide opioids for the medical market. But Alvaro, one of the issues that I wanted to ask you kind of feeds on from our Mexico panel the other day, where my question to you would have been, is literature in Mexico, probably more widely in Latin America, the last retreat of the left? And I wondered maybe if you would like to comment on that, but clearly within the wider context of some of these points you were raising the other day about the inequalities and poverty in Mexico, but feel free to interpret the question however you would like.
Those feeling free things are very scary for me. But I would just ask a brick that you surely know, because you know much more than anyone else here about drug policy. We Mexicans tend to blame the Americans on everything, and that includes the fact that they are having the fun with the drugs and we are putting the dead people. But it is true too, and surely you I don't remember who is the author of this studio. The beginning of the prohibitionary spirit in the fight against drugs began in Mexico before the Mexican Revolution, during the Porfirista regime. Mexico was redesigned by Porfirio Díaz. Mexico maybe didn't exist even before Porfirio Díaz. It was a multitude of nations coming together. And it was the regime of Porfirio Díaz who put certain order. And Porfirio Díaz was a soldier who had become a general, a very brilliant military guy, very, very brilliant, and a very efficient politician. So he traced this division between people who consumed marijuana, that was a drug consumed by soldiers and poor people, and people who consumed cognac. That was what the rich people, usually the highly educated urban population, would consume. And it was in that moment where the Christian Americans bought that ideology. But I think that is important to state in this debate that must be by nature global, because as long as we keep considering national problems, we will not be able to resolve it. And I think that is important to state that in honor of the question the other day. No, are we having memory? Are we writing about that? Are we knowing what is going on? So I think that it's not that I rejoice in remarking that everything that doesn't work in the world comes from Mexico, but it makes me a little bit nervous, the fact that we began that war that we are paying by now. No? And it is important, what everybody is insisting, that it has been mainly a class issue. In the US, the political discussion always goes to the field of the race, and in Mexico, it always goes to the field of the class, even when both countries are brutally racist and brutally classist. No, but we just define them in different terms. So just state that, and what you were saying. No, I was very active for years in the fight for legalization of drugs as the only solution of the problem, because as you said, people will consume them. There's nothing to do. And there was a moment in which that was sexy, fun, and seemed productive. And not seeing that you were being able to change someone's perception about drug consumption. Maybe my mother, no, who I could argue directly, but at least one person. Now there is this very strong movement in Latin America that includes one Colombian ex-president and two Mexican ex-presidents. One of them is always in Opeasus, that is President Fox, so we can just take him on. But President Zedillo, that maybe is the only respectable Mexican ex-president alive, is very active in the United States and in the international community, trying to move forward the idea of legalization as the only solution to the problem. Because we need that tax money in Iguala. You know, what you must do is just legalize and tax, and that's it. But there is what I imagine. You use the word conspiracy, and I love it because it's real. No, we really don't know. We still don't know. It's still so opaque what is behind the drug trade. No? Who is getting the money? Who is certainly El Chapo is not getting all the money. some of it, you know, but not all of it. The money is being redistributed, and it's not clear where it's going. And the people who has the responsibility of following that money is not following it, no, which makes me think about the conspiracy, something I would not sustain in public, and because we don't have arguments. But the first thing we need is transparency. To know what really is going on. I don't know if you remember, in the beginning, when the problem began in Mexico in 2006, we simply didn't understand. No, there was the people, that was all. No, we understood the factions, the involvement of the government. It was very opaque, thanks to the work of a group of heroic journalists in the last years. We understand now perfectly how the Mexican drug markets work. You know, but still we don't know where the money goes. And how is that involved with the United States? What happens with the drugs arrive to Spain in the south? We know that. You know, and to the south of the US too. But then who distributes them? How they work? So I think that the first effort we should do is just clarify, you know, how it works and then take decisions. Now, I understand that the position of legalizing tax maybe a little bit uncomfortable for someone that grew up with conservative values, and I have respect for the values of the people. So we should not enforce that, maybe, I think now, as I thought before. But certainly, we need information. I think that is like a human claim. No? Claim. We just need information. We don't know.
Can I say something about this? And I think that, I don't know if you, Alvaro and Reyna, will agree, but I think that now people in Mexico are much more tired of the violence than the drugs. I mean, what changed in the last 10 years? I mean, there were already drug cartels, there were already like mythological figures of drug lords, but what changed is that there's been like 100,000 people dead in these last 10 years, and I think that is really what is making people sick, the violence, which is what changed when the army was put out on the street to fight the drug cartels, but not much the drug themselves as the bloodbath they are producing.
I think that in the last years, I'm monopolizing, I'm sorry, in the last year there has been a change in the conscience. No, that I think that in general, the urban educated classes will think that an adult will do, a functional adult will do recreational drugs from time to time. I think that taboo of the previous generations is totally erased, and the governments, my question is there, why? Insisting in the fact of controlling your right to have fun. No?
I know, I looked it up before I came over here. In 2015, last year, the United States budget for the war on drugs was $26 billion, federal, billion. Then another $25 billion goes to the state governments and local governments to help militarize and force the war on drugs. That's $51 billion a year to perpetuate this type of thing. And it clearly, to me, is slavery, because in the United States, because the people, when I was in prison, you could work. I was white, I had the option to work or not work. And it was 17 cents an hour is what they paid to be making Victoria's Secret's panties or assembling furniture for Target or whatever. 17 cents an hour. I mean, you work 40 hours a week and you could get 1.5 packs of cigarettes. And another thing that the black people were aware of too was that not only did they take away the people's freedom, but right on the clothing they would put property of. And I'd seen this all the time on TV, like whenever they'd show people in jail, it would say, property of New Mexico, property of California, property of such and such. But the black people were like, well, once you become property, you're no longer a human being. You're like a slave to the system. And then they were working for free, you know, practically for free and everything like that. And so I think that it seems only reasonable to believe that if they would do this on purpose in the United States. And see, it has to be, I think it has to be on purpose, because it was accidentally racist, if they accidentally decided, oh, well, we're locking up all these black people and stuff, or Latino people, whatever, we're locking all these poor people up, well, it looks racist, or maybe it was by the way we wrote the laws or whatever, they would change it. If they didn't want to be racist, Hillary Clinton, somebody would step forward and say, we need to stop being racist. We need to stop doing this type of enslaving of people. But because nobody ever, people know it. People say, oh, all the black people get locked up all the time and stuff like that. It's racist. But it really, really, really is. I believe it. There's no excuse for it, and they should try to stop that.
Let me make the numbers. It's at least $12 a day, you were saying, what a person that works in the poppy fields make.
$12 a pizza.
A la pizza. So it's less than that. Yeah. Anyway, someone in a prison makes...
Because the average salary is 100 pesos, but if they work in the fields,
they could make up to three times as much that day, so like 300 pesos.
Yeah, but in a prison, it's 1.38 cents a day. Mm. So it's even worse than the most marginal of the marginal populations of Mexico. It's brutal.
Yes.
I think another important aspect of this is that actually 90% of the profits in the cocaine trade is realized at the wholesale level and the retail level, which, as I'm sure you're aware, is in the United States of America itself. So actually, these key drug-producing countries actually only retain about 10 to 15% of the profits in the drug trade. And I think one of the, Eduardo's point about Zedillo, we have Gaviria, we have Cardoso, former president of Brazil, and Ruth Dreyfus, the former president of Switzerland, who I mentioned before, who are now in the Global Commission on Drugs, which we also have Richard Branson and various other high-level figures who have become a very powerful advocacy for change to international drug laws. But one of the other points I just wanted to make very quickly, and this I think has impacted Mexico in particular, is the idea of counter-narcotics, is that the state is good and the drug traffickers are bad, and therefore all of these resources go to the drug counter-narcotics enforcement. But the reality, as we know, I mean, one of the most brutal cartel organizations that you have in Mexico is the Zetas, who were originally trained as counter-narcotics operatives, but then realized that there was more money to be made actually in the drug trade, and so they switched sides. And all the circulation of weapons, the state's implication in this, the police, the prison system, this privatization of the prison system in the US. So there are enormous profits being made, and the big challenge is how we actually reduce the vested interests in carrying on the drug war. Brian?
That's another thing. You mentioned in the slides earlier, a long time ago in the United States, they prohibited alcohol. And it lasted, I think, maybe over 10 years, mm-hmm. like 13 or 15 years, something like this. Well, all of these people in the government were getting money from the criminals, like the judges, the lawyers, the police, all these people, like Al Capone, you see it in the movies, they pay all these people off, all these people were getting money. And the reason why the drug war has gone on for way too long is because all of these same types of people, these same people that have these occupations, the police, the judges, the lawyers, all these people are getting paid. But this time, they're not getting paid necessarily by like El Chapo and different people. They're getting paid by the United States government. And so that all of these people are addicted to making all of this money. And they try to blame it on addicts. And they say, like, we have this drug problem. We need, look at, you don't want to walk down the street and have people begging for money, or the drug abuse is so terrible, and all of this type of stuff. And really, when you look at who is buying all of these drugs that are coming from Mexico, it's not 1.9% of the population of addicts. There's not enough addicts in the United States to pay for all of these kilos of cocaine and stuff. It's all of these recreational drug users and all of these white people that don't get arrested for it and stuff. And there's like so much more of a percentage of people that do drugs than are addicted to drugs. It's not even real. It's a health crisis for the people that are addicted, but they use this type of fear of the addict and the criminal to keep lining their own pockets and keep getting their own money each time. It's disgusting, really.
I want to say something that Julia just said about the police and the cartels working together, because that kind of comes back to what happened with the 43 students who disappeared in my hometown. That's why it has been such a huge case, because it was this tragedy that happened with the 43 students, it really highlighted how the police is working in conjunction with the cartel. And it's not just the local police, even though the Mexican government kept trying to keep it local, as a local thing that happened. They kept trying to say, oh, it was just the Iguala police that participated, where there has been so many witnesses that have said it wasn't just the local police, it was the state police, it was the federal police as well. So you're seeing all three branches of government at play in this situation, working with the cartel. And one of the theories about why the students were detained and why they were confronted by the police was that they had borrowed a bus. Though they came to my hometown to borrow buses because they were going to go to a protest or an event in Mexico City. And they had borrowed 5 buses, but the report, at first they mentioned 5 and then they switched it to 4. And everybody was saying, well, what happened to the 5th bus? And one of the theories is that that 5th bus was loaded with heroin paste. And that's why the police stopped the students from leaving the city, because of these drugs that were in the bus that they had borrowed. So for me, like, that really highlights how the police that, you know, the U.S. is sending money to fund the war on drugs so that the Mexican government can fight the cartels. And but what happened in my hometown really highlights how they are actually working together.
Yeah, I think that you're absolutely right. And that difficult or the tragic part is that the economic arrangement or the economic dimension, which obviously is huge in the drug trade, makes complete sense in terms of the international balance of power. You were just mentioning, Julia, that only 10 or 50% of the income is retained in the countries where the drugs are produced and the killings are also produced. But I think that Reyna is also raising a very good point, and I think it, even though it might be much less difficult to empathize with the local police of a Mexican state than with the poor producer, I mean, they do have a choice, but it's a difficult choice. I mean, if you're a policeman if you're the chief of police in an obscure town in Tamaulipas, and you know that if you even dare to oppose the Zetas, they're not only gonna kill you, they're gonna do much worse things. So the choice is between being a policeman that makes a 4,000 peso salary or accept a bribe, or else be killed. And also I think that another dimension of the business that is super important is that the sales of weapons, not only to the Mexican army, but also to the cartels themselves. I mean, every time that a petty drug dealer is captured, I'm not talking about El Chapo or whatever, they have such an arsenal. They have like 2 grenades, 3 bazookas, like, wow. I mean, so that money that the U.S. is pouring to fight the war on drugs, a part of it is coming back through the sales of arms to the cartels themselves, because it's the U.S. that is arming the cartels. So the tragic thing for me is that if you look at it from a global economic perspective of who's getting the benefits, it's a system that makes sense. And as I don't know if Bryan or Julia or both were saying, that there is a lot of vested interest, and I think that is the toughest part to break, because many, many people are benefiting from the way the system works, because it actually does work. I mean, horrific as it might seem, it's a system that works.
Mm-hmm. I think that you make an important point there, that is the class issue. You know, when the parents of the 43 began to become public, they could do these press conferences that showed up in TV and radio. Now no one listens to them anymore, or they get less and less attention. But in the moment, they could be, there's total freedom of expression in Mexico, and the news would get the conferences, so they will show up. And the thing that moved me, seeing it from the privileged situation of a writer living in New York, whatever, but what moved me in that moment, what I found tremendously sad and moving, was the fact that the parents of the kids were clearly non-first, the language of the parents of the kids, the first one was not Spanish. No? They were obviously people who, for whom Spanish was the second language, and they could be, depending, you would know better than I do, I suppose that they were speakers of Nahua, no? Because of the way in which they could conjugate the verbs and use the diminutives and everything, it was very clear that they were, that their mother language was not Spanish. No?
Well, the students, they're from rural communities. So a lot of those communities, they're like from the, you know, Las Montañas, from the Costa.
That is where the language survives and where the population more marginalized from Mexico.
Yeah, these are really poor kids, yes, from very poor families.
But what was amazing is that after that, the police began to get the policemen that had, I don't know if killed, but at least detained the students. We still don't know who killed them, really. We really don't know yet. But anyway, they were able to grab, there's like, I don't know, already 40-something people in jail because of this crime. And when the interviews, with the interrogations with the policemen who commit the crime came out, and you can hear that in the internet, they belong exactly to the same communities. They would be speaking the same kind of learned at school Spanish. No, which means that the NAFTA territory is not working very clearly for a part of Mexico. No matter what we do, there will be always in the U.S. a black population that will be marginalized and brutalized. And no matter what we do in Mexico, always the original population of Mexico will be the most punished. In this global scenario, no? Which,
well, I mean, it's usually the poorest people, and the poorest people tend to be the indigenous people, and which it's kind of a hypocrisy in Mexico, because they, you know, in Mexico, like when you like the bills, right, for the money, like they have all these Aztec symbols, and they have all these indigenous everything, and they really like celebrate the indigenous past. But then the living indigenous peoples and the communities that are still there, they get so marginalized and abused and mistreated. And to me, it's always been a hypocrisy. It's like, how can we put Aztec symbols on our you know, bills, and yet turn around and totally discriminate the indigenous population?
We were talking about the figures involved in the drug war, and Bryan, you cited about $51 billion on the part of the U.S. per year. And it's estimated, we don't know because it's very difficult to quantify the trade in drugs, but it's estimated to be valued at between $300 and $450 billion a year. And this is, if you think about it, this is just shrubs. This is just weeds that grow wild. But the minute you make this illegal, you have generated this vast, lucrative criminal industry. I think a very important point that Bryan makes is that most people who use drugs are non-problematic users. The UNODC, the United Nations Office on Drugs and Crime, estimates that only 1 in 10 people who use drugs have any form of problem in terms of dependency or addiction. So there is a real imbalance here. Although the big problem we have with drugs is evidence, because clearly if you have criminalized drugs and you're doing a survey on drugs and you say to somebody in a country where they have the death penalty, when did you last use cocaine? Clearly you're not gonna have a very reliable sample of people answering your questions. Mm-hmm. So we have no real knowledge of how large the drug using population is. But we have a number of countries now which are moving towards some form of decriminalization or legalization of medical marijuana. Because it's very important to understand it's not just a binary choice between either prohibition or legalization. There's lots of other options in the middle. Jamaica, Portugal, the Czech Republic, the Netherlands, Uruguay, Bolivia are all moving now towards some form of decriminalization. Bolivia has now legalized the cultivation of the coca leaf. which just kind of brings me to the irony of the United States at the state level has decriminalized or legalized in around 20 states now, while at the same time telling Mexico it is a failed state for failing to control the drugs. How do we understand this imbalance between Colorado, Washington, legal marijuana, and yet Mexico is a failed state and is being continually supplied with arms in order to repress the drug trade?
To keep it unstable. To keep the country unstable, probably. And it really seems silly to me, except it's so serious, that, like you say, anyone can grow a marijuana plant. Anyone can make drugs in their car, rent a hotel room, make crystal meth. I mean, it's not like there's never any way that they can stop it. And one time I was performing in Virginia, and all of the kids were telling me, "Oh, we've made up our own drug. We just started putting all these chemicals together, and we passed out in the street, and we were hallucinating and hoping we wouldn't get run over and stuff like that." And it's just like there's no way they can stop people from doing drugs. It's just silly. Mm-hmm. And I don't know. It's just silly to me. Mm-hmm. But it's really a serious thing. Because people are getting killed for it all the time. That's another thing. The control. As soon as they learned this with the alcohol, as soon as they say, you can't do this anymore, they give up all control of that thing, no matter what it is. If they mm-hmm. say, you can't do this, this is against the law, or whatever, they no longer have the power to control it, and other people will take over that responsibility and stuff.
But that precisely that movement produces, at least in Mexico, is what has been going on, produces parastates, no? Places where the state doesn't have injuries anymore and are sort of free pirate republics that are governed de facto by a cartel, where many dirty things that need to be done in order to produce political order can happen. Is the case of Iguala very clearly. No? The school from where the 43rd students come is historically a place where guerrilla fighters were educated, is historically an ultra-Marxist school. So the fact that that becomes a blind area for the government, because it's actually governed by a group of thugs with guns, is very comfortable for the state. You can actually take the 43 over. No? The thing is that, as Eduardo said, people is just completely sick of it. Mm-hmm. No? The 43 students dead is nothing in Mexico. No? We had a massacre that size every week, you know? but the fact that they were students and everything really changed the conscience. And I think that there is a strong, you will be able to tell us, there is a strong movement, no, for legalization, at least of marijuana by now in Mexico. No?
Yeah, and even the president, who nobody really likes, but even he sent a... Yeah,
even heroin,
he
they want
to
legalize that too.
To increase the amount of marijuana that you can carry. And I think it was
and
like
heroin.
5 grams, which is like for a night out, more than enough. Yeah.
And in Mexico City, you can consume the marijuana that if you didn't, what is illegal is to buy it. No?
Yeah.
But you can have as much or not.
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't have it that clear.
No, but that's the thing. There is a limit, which is not bad. But the problem is that in practice, if you are on the street and doing a joint and the police catch you and you say, no, but it's legal, there is no way they're going to respect it. I mean, and there's many cases of people that they take down and they plant cocaine or they plant, I mean, I guess that it is a movement in that direction, but I think that up to now it's not really... And again, it will be the same. I mean, if you get stopped in a posh neighborhood in Mexico City with a small bag of marijuana, I think that is not so bad. But if you get stopped in a rougher part of town or you come from a less privileged social background, you're going to be in trouble for sure.
One of the... Oh, sorry.
If we could bring the conversation back to art. I really love something Bryan said at the beginning of the panel where he said that art changes lives. And I would like to bring the conversation back to art because of what he said. And I kind of feel like that's something that, that's also creating the problem with drug addiction, is that, especially, you know, in the US where I live, over the years, the government has been taking away art from schools. And children don't have access to art the way they used to. Like 30 years ago when I was in school, in junior high, high school, we used to have dance classes, music classes, art classes, and I did everything. You know, I was in marching band, I was in concert band, I was taking art and painting, and there were art classes and ceramics and wood shop and metal shop, I mean, everything. Now, my children don't have access to any of that, because that has been taken away from the public schools. So children don't have access to music, they don't have access to art, they don't have access to dance. And that really affects the low-income children, because their parents cannot afford to pay for these classes. So now, like, if I want my daughter to take piano, for example, like, we're paying $135 a month for her to have a piano class after school. And I'm raising that point because I really do feel that there's a correlation with the lack of access to art with our children, especially our low-income kids, and the drug consumption and the addiction, the increase in addiction that has been, you know, happening in the U.S. Because I really do believe that, you know, as human beings, we need a way of self-expression. You know, we are, as human beings, we're emotional, we feel things, and we need to express all these feelings, and usually art is a perfect way of us to be able to express ourselves in a very positive way. But when we take that away from children, then what do we leave them with? And we have to express ourselves. It has to come out. So we're either gonna implode or explode. But one way or another, it's gonna come out. And that's why I feel like there has been such an increase in drug abuse, alcohol abuse, or even violence. You know, as we have seen in the United States, it has become commonplace for young people to go into a school or into a movie theater and shoot people. And that's a form of self-expression. So I really do believe, like, you know, celebrating the arts and bringing the arts back into our communities, into us, our schools, that's one way that we can fight the war on drugs and the war on alcohol and the war on violence, is to give students and give our young people a way of self-expression that is healthy and creative and beautiful, and that's what art does in our communities. And ultimately, art is what's gonna save us.
But I just wanna say that it might be different in Mexico than in the US, but, and I don't know if you agree with this, Alvaro, but you probably do because we share many friends, that in Mexico, some of the people that take most drugs are the artists themselves, I think.
I think that you have the right to do research on your own brain as a human being, as you have the right to do research on your own body. Why you can make a tattoo on your body and you cannot inflict a little bit of heroin to see how it feels? I don't understand who draws the line and why. No, in which moment? This is, now you're speaking about the legalization of pot. No, that would be for Mexico, would be a great relief because a big chunk of the market and the violence is associated to pot. No? And that will eventually happen because the Americans will legalize it soon and that will be it. But anyway, why? Why pot not? No, who decided that? It's Porfirio Diaz. We fought the fucking revolution and threw him out. He died in France. No, it was his idea. No, why are we still... I don't know. The idea of art saving us from drugs puts the ball on the wrong, I think, on the wrong side of the field, because there's nothing to be saved. There is a medical problem. There is a health issue that must be addressed by the state with the taxes that you claim from selling those drugs. The model is simpler than the other model. No, I...
Okay.
I'll hand over to Bryan. Clearly, Bryan's got far more to say about the role between the relationship between drugs and art, but I think Reyna's point about this diminishing of space and creativity is very, very important. And I think the big challenge is that it's about identity for young people, and that the identity that they were able to self-express is now lost, and that becomes expressed through gang cultures and these kind of aspects. But clearly we have a very long history of the relationship between drugs and art, and some of the most astonishing paintings and writings and poems have been written and conceived during drug use. But that's really the problem, I would say. People, you know, dating right back to somebody like, you know, Quincy, is if you think about artists and writers, who are they? Well, they're all kinds of deviant, aren't they? They're left-wing, they're gay, sometimes they're different colours from us. So drug laws are actually targeted at artists, I would say, in particular, because deviant, they are part of this deviant group.
Right. I was just telling Bryan that I am a really boring artist because I don't do drugs, I don't drink, and I don't smoke. So, yeah, I think maybe I need to pick up something, right?
Well, I personally, I think that for me, I did art before I did drugs, and I think there was several different, for those that don't know, I draw my picture, a self-portrait, at least one, every single day, and I haven't missed a day in over 21 years. And no two pictures are the same. Every day I try to find something totally different or unique in the world, or in my thoughts, or my dreams, or anything like that. And but I think it's about maybe 5 years into drawing myself every day. What I started realizing was I wasn't illustrating what I was doing every day. I wasn't, like, if I went to the store, I wouldn't draw a picture of myself walking into a store for that day. What I was trying to do was channel different experiences. And I learned pretty quickly that environments had a much bigger influence on how I perceived myself in a wider, more creative way than almost anything. And so I started controlling my environments and started doing a whole bunch of different, really interesting types of pictures. But then I had a little bit of, I guess you would call it, not really trauma. It didn't happen to me, but I went through a bad episode where one of my friends burned to death in a house fire and another friend shot himself in the head. But he survived. It went through one temple and out the other, and then he was really messed up when they finally got him out of the coma and everything. And so then I went through this period of depression. And I was doing good pictures when I was depressed too every day. It was very therapeutic to be doing this self-portraits every day. And I had also by then learned that there was nothing could happen to me that I wouldn't be able to translate with art. If I had a terrible headache, I could do a self-portrait with a terrible headache. If I was really tired and could barely keep my eyes open, I could do a really tired self-portrait. There was like nothing that could prevent me from transcribing my feelings with art. So I was having this depression and stuff. Well, then one of my lungs collapsed. And so then I had to go to the hospital and they removed part of my lung. And then I didn't realize that I wasn't supposed to be able to like walk up and down stairs or ride a bicycle. The doctor never said, you're not going to be able to do this, you're not going to be able to do that. And I was just drawing cool pictures of myself with these wounds and things. And so then I went hiking, and I'd never really been outdoors before. And I thought, well, that's a great environment. I've never been in this type of environment before. So I spent 2 months outdoors, walking in the woods, drawing myself. I had like 5 pounds of art supplies every day and was really doing great pictures with that. And I was with a friend and he said to me, well, I thought you were going to make a documentary. He said, you've gotten all wrapped up in these self-portraits and yourself and the feelings and all this type of stuff. He said, I thought you always wanted to make a documentary about all of these really interesting people in your building, because I live in a big 11-story apartment building. And I said, well, I got there, and then everyone was on drugs. I said that I thought it would be cool to interview all of these people, like war veterans or just different types of people, but if they don't take drugs for fun, they take drugs, psychiatric drugs or something, and they just sit in their chair all day. And the social worker, like the case management people, had told me if most of the people got out of their chair three times a day away from the TV, that was a good day. And I said, you can't really make a documentary about this because it's just the people are all on drugs. And then there was a guy, after I got done hiking, there was a guy in my building that was in a paralyzed from a car accident, was in a wheelchair, and he had a book, like an encyclopedia, big, huge book of every single drug in the world. Every pill had a picture of every single thing. And he said, you can get one of everything in this book in this building. And I said, that's my next project. I'm going to take one of every one of these drugs and I'm going to draw myself every single day and see how this changes me and stuff. But then after like 11 day, 18 drugs, at first it was really interesting. And like I said, there was this kind of element of self-abuse, like I had this depression and different things. But at the same time, art was giving me a lot of hope for life and really gave me a lot of inspiration and a creativity. And then when I started, I took some pills. I hope you don't. Am I talking too long?
No.
Okay. So when I took like one pill or something, because I didn't want to mix them. I didn't know what all these different things would do. And the picture was really interesting, and I couldn't wait till the next day. I was like, next day I'm going to take another one. Well, really quickly, people found out in my apartment building that I was doing this experiment, because they all knew I drew myself every day already. So people just started knocking on my door and just giving me all of their pills. And so then I was really, the pictures were turning out really interesting, really diverse. Not nearly as extreme as being in the woods, but yet there was some interesting things happening with the lack of motor skills from the pills. And some of them with the tension too would really either increase my attention or decrease my attention. And so I started taking like one a day. And then I started taking like two or three different ones a day. Then I started taking like two or three at a time, like different ones. And so it was like really getting out of control and my friends were all worried about me. And then someone gave me some PCP or something and I lost my mind. And then I went to the psychiatrist, like I volunteered and I said, look, I'm doing this experiment. I've been taking all these pills and I had all my artwork with me. And I said, look here, this is me on this pill, this is me smoking weed, this is me on acid, this is me on mushrooms. I said, I would like you to help me and write me a prescription for just one pill, you know, like every other day or something like that, so I don't get too carried away, of every type of pill that you think would help this art project along. And then he gives me a prescription for 100 heavy tranquilizer pills, because he thought I needed to really be tranquilized. And so I thought, well, that was one of the things on my list. I want to get tranquilized. So then I went to the pharmacy and got the pills. And then I really had an experience that changed my whole attitude about a lot of things and animals too. I never had such a profound experience where my mind was totally severed from my physical body. And sometimes drugs would really give me a feeling like I was more in control or my imagination was more in control or something like this. But this tranquilizer pill, I'd seen on TV a lot of times, like Africa or somewhere, there's an animal, like a bear in a tree or something in my neighborhood, and then the police would shoot it with a tranquilizer dart and it would look like really drunk and fall down or something like that. And they look kind of cute and everything when they like do their whatever, their veterinary medicine on them. So anyways, I start to draw, I take this pill and I'm sitting in front of my giant mirror and I'm like waiting for it to kick in, just getting my proportions right and everything. And then about maybe 30 to 40 minutes of just barely trying to get my eyes in a faint outline, all of a sudden, this terrible electrical type of impulse just went like this and like really made me cringe up like that. And I thought, oh, maybe I should just focus on drawing. Like, this is going to be really powerful. So I just tried to put all of my attention into my book and start to draw, and then it went, don't draw. And I thought, oh, maybe I need to lay down. And I looked over at my bed like this, and it went, don't look at your bed. And then it really separated my mind from my body. And then all of a sudden, I thought, wow, all of these animals, because my mind was still very active. I could still think and have memories and everything, but my body was not allowed to do anything. This tranquilizer was separating it. And I realized that when they shoot a lion to like pull a thorn or something out of its foot, that lion is still a lion. He's not drunk or like relaxing or chill or something. He's wanting to chew those throats out of all the people that are bothering it. But there's just this thing telling the lion, like, don't look at their throats. Don't think about eating them, like this. And so I had to fight it, like, really, really hard. And now I see a lot of times the psychiatric medicine, because a lot of people had offered me psychiatric medicine. And a lot of times people criticize me when they see this project because they say, why do you take antidepressants? Or why do you take antipsychotics? You know, these aren't real drugs or something. But so many people, it goes back to the whole drugs thing, they want everyone to be on drugs. They just want to select which ones you can take, which ones you can't take. And my mother, I used to criticize my mother a lot for the way she had raised me, but one thing I'm really thankful for is, I was always an anxious, intelligent child. She never let them drug me as a child. Whenever they would say, Brian's out of control, he won't stop fidgeting, he won't stop jumping up and down, he won't stop cussing or whatever, fighting or whatever, she would never let them drug me. But now in the United States, all of these creative, intelligent children that answer out of turn, that can't sit in their seats, the school is starting to diagnose them. The teachers have a checklist of 9 criteria. One of them is like, are they squirming in their seat? Another one is, are they talking too much? Are they talking out of turn? And if a child has 6 of these 9 problems, this teacher is not a psychiatrist, is diagnosing these children with having attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. And then if the parents refuse to in many cases, if the parents refuse to drug the children, they say it's abuse, and the state will step in and force these children to be drugged. And so now there's a whole lot of, there's going to be a whole generation of children, probably for the last 10 or 20 years, that never have the opportunity to really express themselves. Because once you start taking this, I know quite a few people that have taken these medications, that they'll say, okay, you're hyperactive, so they give you this pill for hyperactivity or whatever, because they want everyone to stay and be alike. Every child must be the same and be orderly. But then some kids take this medicine, and then they get depressed. They don't feel the same. They can't, you know, they're sitting in their seat, but they start chewing on things. They can't stop, you know, having some other problems. So then they give them an antidepressant, and then they start medicating all of the side effects that the first drug gives them. So now you have children that are like 16, 17 years old on 3 or 4 different types of psychiatric medicines and stuff. And I believe this is why a lot of the children go back into the schools and start shooting up the schools and stuff, because people have always had guns in the United States. They've always been around people's houses and everything. I had a gun when I was 6 years old. I got a rifle for my 6th birthday. But I really think that when they start messing with all of these children's creativity and start messing with their minds and their chemical, their brain chemistry, that's when they start creating all of these really terrible things. Sorry for talking so long, I get sidetracked.
What they are generating, Bryan, is super academics. Super academic. No, no, it's a known fact that everybody just pretends in this double discourse and this tremendous hypocrisy. Mm-hmm. But it is a fact that the students of Ivy Leagues, they all take Adderalls. Mm-hmm. Adderalls. Yes, yes, they would not be able to produce the amount of papers mm-hmm. that are claimed mm-hmm. from them and then keep attending classes. I'm not making any kind of recommendation from the students of this program. No, no, but it is a fact. I did my PhD in a public school in the 90s, and we used coffee and whiskey, the classic. Mm-hmm. You know? And now the kids are up to the top with chochos, we say in Spanish, with pills, and they can sustain this super productivity. So what we will see is the normalization of that state of hyperproductivity that is so good for the capitalist society. System, you know, is the to take out the idea of recreation, of the notion of drunk consumption, or to take out the idea of creativity, of free creativity, to produce chain texts and etc.
No, I think that's a very valuable point, and also the fact that it's I think to kind of emphasize Bryan. When it's pharmaceutical companies that are making the profit from mass prescription, then it's perfectly fine and legitimate. And this, again, I would suggest is maybe an imbalance between the way we treat naturally occurring drugs that grow and synthetic drugs that are manufactured by pharmaceutical companies. And I think that's why we don't know the names of the cartel leaders in places like the Netherlands. This has felt like a very private conversation. Would anybody like to ask any questions? Yes, sir. She's running away, I think.
Sorry. I want to give art and drugs, I want to give another dimension, the political control of drugs or the supply of drugs. I supervised the head of the drug squad in the whole United Arab Emirates. He was given permission by the Ministry of Interior to do this research under one condition. All the files at his disposal should not be seen by the outside world, understandably. Why? There are two types of drug addicts. By the immigrants and their punishment, put them in a prison and deport them immediately. There is no rehab, sadly. Now, the others, which really I want to highlight, is the political authority. Those are shipped when two clinics, Israel and Switzerland. That's what, because these two countries were not, to reveal who is the sons and daughter of all those sheikhs outside. Where if you send them somewhere else, there is all, particularly London, there may be a problem here. Things will slip. But I asked, one of this, I said, who supply the drugs? And this is what really I want to know. It doesn't come on overland, it doesn't come by sea. It comes by private jets, which are owned by the political authority, because they are not inspected by the customs. And this is how supplies, and it's a big problem, a big problem. His thesis, which I approved of, is still, nobody can access it because it could be very explosive. But what I want to say, how the political authority are responsible for supplying the drugs, not stopping it, but supplying it. Thank you.
Just take another couple of points, and then we can make some comments. Does anybody else have any questions at all? Yeah.
At the beginning, I don't know if you were mentioning half jokingly. You said you spoke about a possibility of a conspiracy within the frame of the war on drugs. I was wondering if anyone could comment about the possibility of the war on drugs being inevitably related with neoliberalism, both as an ideology and as an economical and financial system. As an ideology, in the following way, three of the main traits of neoliberalism are individualism, consumption, and the need for instant satisfaction. The three of them go very well with the consumption of drugs. And in the other way, as a financial and economical model, it's a very schizophrenic thing for governments to pursue the drug dealers in such a violent manner and turn their backs into the financial system, where it would be very easy to, you know, to find where this money is being transported to and fro. I have a close friend who used to be a high executive in a Mexican bank, and he said that every day they filed over thousands of reports to the Mexican authorities about suspicious movements, and they'd received no one single order of disclosing that information. So in the financial system is absolutely colluded with the drug trafficking, and it's hardly ever the war on drugs is hardly ever goes to that discussion, and the financial system is possibly the backbone right now of the economical model.
I know in the United States, not with the trafficking, but the financial system, probably in the 90s, maybe the 80s, my aunt used to work at a factory, and then it closed down. It went overseas or something like that, and that's when I first started hearing about the losing the jobs all the time. They would say, America's losing its jobs, and then the economy. Well, then it got to a point where whole towns, little towns, would start failing and going bankrupt. And then the private prison thing started, and I'm not exactly sure, like maybe in the 90s or something, they started privatizing the prisons because the prisons, well, they were so overcrowded. Well, then once the business really got into it full swing, it seems to me that they were doing it like a real estate. And they would say, like, okay, this building has so many rooms in it available, so many vacancies. We get so much money per person, so we have to keep this full to make the most money. But then I know there's at least one, if not two, corporations in the United States that trade in stocks based on how many people are incarcerated in these private prisons. Their stock goes up the more people they have in prison, and then people start going down. And then every now and then they will mention on the news, like, in these around these towns, the conviction rate is almost 100%. It's like, oh, well over 90%. You get arrested for drugs, you're going into this type of system and stuff like that. And they have children. But I can't recall the names of these corporations offhand that deal in how many people are incarcerated, but I'm sure it's easy to find online. I'm sure it's well integrated. The whole thing is a business. The whole thing is economics, and it's, to me, it's a whole thing.
But it's just, oh, sorry, Wolfgang.
Thank you, Bryan. I just wanted to confirm what you just said. Indeed, those corporations exist. In fact, before they build new prisons, they give certain occupancy guarantee rates and have private services that ensure the arrest of drug offenders. That's not even run anymore by the police officials. I would like to know from you, being an insider, having seen both the outside and the inside, you talked about what is essentially the political economy of this, the politics and the economics. Where would you start to unravel the system? Where would you start to dismantle the system? It seems to me it is almost impossible, given the interests, the political and the economic interests behind it. Is it even possible to unravel it, and where would you start? What kind of incentives would you create, and what kind of money would you have to need to create alternative economies and sources of income for all these people who now make a living of this?
It seems a totally overwhelming, impossible. But for me, because I'm an artist and I liked my imagination, and I think there has to be a way to win and survive and overcome these types of things. And I haven't finalized my ideas about this, but when I first started making art, I used to think What you had to do when you were faced with a social situation was find a problem and then expose it to the people so you can inspire change. So I would think to myself, like, okay, I know there's a problem with X. So I would get some graphic information about X and make like a graphic video, write a graphic story, and I would say, now look at this to the people in the crowd. Like, this is awful. This is the worst ever. Something needs to be done. And I was really caught up in this type of thinking about how art will change the world. But as I've started getting older now, I've started changing this opinion. And I think, like I said, I haven't really worked out all of the nuances of this type of idea, but what I believe in the way that change really works is, as an artist, if the artist can create an image to show people, whether it's a story or a painting or a movie, if they can show people the way they want it to be, the way that they hope it to be, it will create this type of mentality where the people can picture it, they can imagine it. Instead of just seeing how bad things are and then they want to escape and go to the movies and watch an action superhero or something like this, if you can create the idea in their mind, in the population, then it's that much easier for people to make this a reality, to realize this type of thing. And I've been thinking a lot, this doesn't have to do with drugs, but I've been thinking a lot in my own art about, when I've thought about this type of idea of switching completely over to hopes and fixing things in the United States, I've thought a lot about children. Because when I went to China, if I talked to anyone in Chinese for 40 minutes, they would say to me, Americans don't love their children. And they would never really explain to me why. It was just a common misconception or conception. It was just a common idea they had, Americans don't love their children. And then a couple times I had experiences with people with children. And then, like, one time they said, why didn't you bring gifts for the children? Like, you're American, Americans don't love their children. I thought, why? Why didn't I bring gifts? Like, I'm such a bad person. I should have thought about the children like this. But then I realized, oh, well, in America, children don't take gifts from strangers. Children don't talk to strangers. Or they tell you early on because the criminals, the people that would do harm to children, they'd not really punish that well and stuff. And so I've been thinking, I've been thinking about applying this type of situation in my art, because I do performance art and other things besides draw myself. I've thought, well, if I could create an image for people to see what it's like for children talking to a stranger, for children taking candy from strangers, and seeing how life could be positively for children, then instead of saying, like, look at these pictures of what these bad people are doing to the children and expecting them, the society, to change the way they do this. I think if you totally switch it to give people hope, and I think this is really a lot of what Obama tried with his speeches and things before he got elected, was providing a better picture for society, but then it didn't really work out like that. But I think this is the way it's going to change, unless a whole lot of wealthy people, a whole lot of wealthy white people fall victim to their own system, then there is no hope.
Would other panel members maybe like to comment on the use of art and literature as a way of giving hope, as a way of articulating opportunity and an alternative?
No, I don't believe that art gives hope, so okay. I cannot comment on that. What I can comment is about this throwing the ball back to your field, that is creating policy, no, doing what you are doing, putting numbers together until the governments begin to have rational theories about it. I think that we have rest the responsibility of the experimentation and intent to be productive with drugs, with artists, and really has not worked, according to those friends you were quoting. So speaking about, so I think that it's time for the academic thinking and political thinkers to think about that. I would connect that with a tiny little part of what Diego said, that I think the problem with neoliberalism is that it's perceived as a void of ideology. No, because of the moment in which it took over the world, no, that was the retirement of the communist countries and the entrance of Maggie Thatcher and Ronald Reagan, the idea, I think that neoliberalism has passed, at least in massive terms, as what comes after ideologies. No? So it has not developed the tools that are necessary to deal with certain social problems. And one of them is the problem of drugs. No? We have all these dark spaces, all these gray areas, because there is not an ideological prescription about what to do with the problem, because there are benefits of not having that description. So policy has been done, thinking has been done by philosophers and political analysts and not artists.
Yeah, I agree with Alvaro. I think that, I mean, much as I would like it to be otherwise, I think it would be naive to think that art, because I think that, I don't know, the first hour maybe of this panel, we spoke, and I think your presentation was very clear on this, Julia, that it's a matter of economics, of politics, of violence, of a balance of power, both in the international system as well as within the country. So, I mean, I don't know that it would be thinking that art can change poverty or that art can change machism, for example, in a country like Mexico, and I don't think it's the case. I do think, and I do agree with this, when Reyna said it before, I don't think it's like the solution, and I think that this also came up in the earlier panel. I think that sometimes the problem is like hanging too much on art or on literature, and unless it's the solution, then it's no good for nothing. And I don't think this is the case. I think that on a minor level or on a local level, it can be very important. I think that, as Reyna was saying, in these rural marginalized communities, it's not going to save the community. Maybe it's not going to change the economic reality, but it can provide an alternative, or even
respiro, like a rest.
Yeah, like a rest from the brutal reality, like an escape, much in the ways that drugs can also do it. I think that there are some similarities there. Yeah, and I think that is more than enough sometimes. I mean, I think that sometimes, I don't know if this is true in other countries, but in Mexico sometimes people give up because it's like, but why are you doing this if it's not going to change like the situation of the country? Like, okay, maybe it's not going to change the situation of the country, but it can be like a refugee for a few people. It can inspire some people to do something else, to give them different ideas, give them different perspectives. And I think that if art does at least a part of that, then it's done pretty much its job.
Well, I don't know. Now I'm kind of confused about all this talk about drugs and art because, you know, like I said, I'm a really boring artist. I don't do drugs. I've never done it. But when Bryan was talking about his experiment, I thought it sounded like a lot of fun. And maybe I should try it. Maybe I'll finally finish my novel if I try a different drug every single day. So now you've convinced me that maybe that's what I need. I don't know. So we kind of defeated the purpose of the panel, talking about all the bad things that drugs bring into our society. But I think that as a society, I think we do have a love-hate relationship with drugs. That on one hand, you know, we're talking about all the negativity, all the violence and you know, the way it affects people and societies in a bad way. But on the other hand, we also romanticize the idea of drugs and artists doing drugs and how cool that is. So we need to have more conversations about this because we really do need to figure out, like, as a society, where do we really stand when it comes to drugs? Are we really against them or are we really for them? Or is there a middle ground that we can explore? But I really do appreciate everything that was brought up in the panel because it does raise those questions, right? Like, where do we stand as a society when it comes to drugs?
But I think that the crucial distinction is between drugs and the way drugs are organized, sold, distributed, and the consequences that they produce. I mean, I don't know anything that is inherent to drugs that it means that if people were taking them, it should cause the horrible things that we all have been talking about. So I think that from my perspective, the emphasis should be on not on drugs, because also, as Bryan said, people are going to take them one way or another. But given that reality, given that drugs are going to be there and that at least some of us agree that they can be a good thing, like rather attacking or changing the way that the system around them is organized, that I think is producing these horrible effects.
Thank you. We're going to just go with a final question, because this is the close of the conference and we need to say a few words of thanks to various people. So I'd like our final question to go to a contributor who's been very much valued during these last few days.
Actually, I don't agree with you, Reyna. You are not a boring artist at all. I was very, very moved by your stories yesterday and the way your memories of your crossing to the States with your father was very powerful and very eloquently put into your reading. I was really very touched, so don't consider yourself a boring artist. And I wanted to say, talking about memory, I actually would like to turn to Bryan to ask him if he remembers the decisions he has to make as an artist, why he uses these forms, these colors, these backgrounds, these images, these numbers, in retrospect, can you go back in your memory and remember why you made this decision? Is it because of the medications you have been under, or is it because of the weather, or is it because of your breakfast, or is it because of your conversations with yourself? What kind of decisions can you remember in retrospect, for example?
It depends for different pictures. A lot of the images, because it's art, it's not science, and so it's, if I was to draw the same exact picture each time, like try to render myself with, say, a pencil each time, the only thing that I would have been getting from the experience is how that drug affected my motor skills. And I've always felt like experience, there's so many different things going on when you experience anything in life, from your memories and your thoughts, like you say, your beliefs and what the weather's like, different things. And so whenever I do something like this, pretty much almost every picture, I don't give myself rules. It's kind of like improv jazz music, like a freestyle or something, like this is how I do it. But I always have all of my supplies laid out. And so I can look at the image and see, like, oh, I made these types of marks, so I know I must have been feeling like this way, or I used this type of subject matter, so I must have been thinking about this. Because it's really impossible, like if I haven't smoked crack yet, but maybe one day I will. And I've thought about it, I use it as an example a lot, because I have a whole lot of experiences in life with crack cocaine. Just from walking down the street in a big city, people would offer me crack, or I watched TV one time and see a comedian talk about crack. So there's no way to start with a perfectly clean slate. You know, if to smoke crack, there's already going to be all of these thoughts and feelings and experiences and stuff that would go into that experience. But when I smoked it, it depends on what I happened to be thinking right then at that moment in time. And I don't know, I can't say what it is, but a lot of times I can go back and say, like, oh, I remember this feeling, that feeling, or these colors, or I felt this way, because a lot of what goes into when I make the pictures and try to channel the experience, it's called a kinesthesia and proprioception, and it's the ability of one to sense feelings inside of the body. And so I have like my own type of marking system with different media and everything. So if I get a pinch, every picture is gonna have the same type of marking system for when I feel a pinch. But then there's different ones. There's thermoception, where you feel different temperatures within yourself. And so I have, there's ways for me to recall a lot of it, but now a lot of things not. But I will like to add one more thing about the drawing the pictures every day. I'm starting to think of them as data now. And so because I scanned them all in, it took me 6 months last year to scan them all into the computer. And now I've started separating them into different aspects of life, like all of the times I've had headaches, all the times I was happy, all the times I was angry. And I've learned that one person is not supposed to be able to remember every single time they were angry for 21 years. Because as I was going through these, I was remembering in the picture. Like, oh, I was angry. I remember that. This person threw a sandwich at me, and I was really mad. And then the next time, the next picture, I was angry. I was like, oh, I remember this. And then it started making me angry all over again. And then I was like, oh, this is not bad. But I'm wanting to eventually, within the next year or two, go through and really start doing experiments with my memories and my emotions and see if I can really have a lot more control over myself. A lot more emotional control over myself, and see if I can manipulate, if I can be more of an active participant instead of just like a sponge or a passive person going around just experiencing whatever happens. I want to be able to really be like my own scientist, even though it's art, and remember it better.
Great, thank you.
I think this has been an extraordinary panel, and it's grouped together a diversity of people with a diversity of experiences. By way of hopefully consoling Reyna, I would just like to add, I work on drug policy, but I also work on food security and sexual violence, and I don't feel the need to starve myself or be assaulted before I teach on those subjects. And I think it's very much the same with how we understand drugs, so please don't feel you need to use crack cocaine to finish off your book. But in particular, I just would like people to really, the final thought here is, you know, when we talk about drugs and violence, and one of the points we've made is this separation between the global north and the markets of the global north, and then what's happening in the global south. And please ask yourself whether it's drugs that cause violence or whether it's counter-narcotics interventions that cause violence. Because when we look at these drug markets in the Netherlands and Poland and various countries where they're not violently intervened in the way that Mexico and Colombia and Peru and Afghanistan have been violently intervened, then we don't see the same levels of violence. I was asked to try and come to some conclusions for the panel, and I hope those maybe give people some ideas to go away with, but can you please show your appreciation for what I hope has been a very frank discussion and one in which we've all probably exposed some of our own vulnerabilities and weaknesses today. So thank you very much. Before everybody runs away, I was asked to just try and present some closing remarks, which is very difficult to do. Normally we do academic conferences, and at the end of an academic conference we have to come up with a theory, or we've arrived with a theory. And I think what's been particularly interesting about what we've done over the last 4 days is that there is such a diversity of perspectives. And I think it's been wonderful to have this level of intellectual chaos and commentary chaos, because there is, I think, far too often in academia, this quest for homogenization of thought and theorization. One of the things that we really did hope to do with this conference was to bridge academia, which, as Bob said before and says on a daily basis, exists in something of an ivory tower. And what we wanted to do is move slightly out of our ivory tower and embrace a different community. And I think the writers and the artists and the editors who we've had here over the last few days have really enabled us to look at the world of policy from a very different perspective. And I would like to thank all of those who have come, in many cases, vast differences, and really transformed our spaces and the spaces within this school. And I think that will have a lasting impact on our own intellectual architectures. And I think my closing conclusion really is that so many people who are working in arts and literature today are very subversive. But tragically, subversion is really arguing against government policies, which for most of us seem so shocking. The racism, our treatment of refugees, of immigration, of the impacts of neoliberalism, and I think what art and this literature has really been able to provide is a platform for expressing some of the most basic freedoms which are no longer being respected. So I'd like to thank everybody for their contributions, but I would just like to, in particular, narrow this down, thanking enormously Suzanne Lane and Ilona Ladalma and Dorothy Lanier and all of the staff in the School of Public Policy and in the Central European University who have provided the administration, which in Hungary, as most of you will know, is no mean feat, which enabled us to get people into the country and to book flights. And so for all of your administration, I am enormously grateful. So many, many thanks. Obviously, the other people that we would like to thank are everybody, all of the writers, all of the artists, the agents, all of the people who've accompanied our guests from a diversity of countries. And I think the real word here is diversity, because the School of Public Policy and the CEU really sees itself as being a beacon of diversity in a country and a region which is facing many difficulties. And so, thank you so much. Who would have thought you could have a conference that brought together Sudan, India, Mexico, Hungary? It's just this diversity has been wonderful, so, and Syria, of course, so many, many thanks. Behind every amazing idea, there is always a crazy, inspired, mad scientist. So, Robert Templer, we salute you. It's really no understatement to say that all of this really has come from Bob, and it's been Bob's ideas which have really brought all of these people together. It's Bob's reading, it's Bob's great embrace of diversity and of seeking constantly to bridge theory and practice and arts and academia that made this conference possible. And I hope what Bob has created will be, as I said before, very lasting for SPP, because I hope that the contacts and the networks that we've made over the last few days are sustained. We've filmed, we've videoed, and we will use all of this for our students. We've had it recorded along the walls, and I would like to thank you in particular for your hard work over these past 2 days. Although I think you may find that myself and Dan Large will be having a word with you later on. But there is one person who has really been the real inspiration for all that we seek to achieve within the school and the school's position internationally in Hungary and within the Central European University. And that is the founding dean of our school, Wolfgang Reinecke, who's deliberately looking in the opposite direction because he said, "Do not mention me." Wolfgang really, as a founding dean, has been inspirational in the type of school that he has sought to create, the type of academics and practitioners that he has sought to attract, and in the students that he wanted to see studying policy in the School of Public Policy. And in particular, his emphasis on mainstreaming rights and justice and freedoms and liberties. But more specifically, Wolfgang intellectually and aesthetically has enabled us to embrace the arts and has been very liberal in comparison to very many deans and heads of school who many of you have probably known before. So I think to have such a cultured dean who has been prepared to put the resources and the time and the energy and the administration of the school into hosting not just this conference but many of the previous conferences, and for founding what I think will be a truly well-renowned international school which really trains our students in understanding the kinds of challenges that our artists and writers have explored over the last few days will be a real testament to Wolfgang. So thank you very much, Wolfgang, for your time and for your contribution to this wonderful community. Thank you.